How did you get involved in show business?
I was 3 years old. And my mother took me to dancing class. Apparently I didn't behave very well on my first day. But Peggy Griffiths hired everybody choosing the piano because there was a clock back on it. So I think I've always been a bit of a rebel and got up the thing. And I put everybody's shoes in the back of the piano. But I was forgiven, carried on at the dancing class. And of course, Hawkesbury was the grassroots for the big pantomime at the Tivoli. And you dance. Come September, you started to rehearse for the pantomime, which was usually in March. And it was just progressive. I carried on dancing class. I carried on in the pantomime. And even when I got too old for dancing class, still in the pantomime. Mondays and Thursdays we practiced. And I think when we were about 10, we played Knick Knock on the way home. We never admitted to it, but we did. And we'd be, at that age, we were coming home at 9 o'clock at night. Now, these days you wouldn't let a 10-year-old come home from dancing 9 o'clock. The scene, the big scenery drops, the big flaps that dropped, they came from London, and our costumes came from London, from Foxes in London, and sort of the latter days, we were measured for whatever item we were in, whichever dance we were in, and our list went down to London, and there came in big skips, and it was Lamb then, with Rosemary Lamb on, you know, Esme Williams. You know, Margaret Evans. And do you know what? We felt like queens. Mr. Hopwood, who played the piano, he smoked, and he would be sitting there, and his ciggy would be in his mouth, and he'd play, and Peggy would say, stop, stop, let's do that again, we'll take that over. And he never moved his cigarette, and the ash was the full length of the cigarette before he put it on the side. He must have had the patience of a saint because the time she started, and because we had the stage to do it on. We had to have tap shoes, we had to have ballet shoes. Our parents in the early days made our costumes, but there was a costume committee, a group of ladies who made them all. And downstairs, there was the senior ladies' dressing room. You know, you daren't go in there. That was strictly off limits. Then as we passed the stairs, there was a room where we had refreshments. Then there was the room where the ladies did the sewing. Then there were another set of stairs up to the men's dressing room. That was off limits as well. And then there was the juniors dressing room, which we all started in. Then the first step of stairs, you went up, there was a dressing room off, a dressing room off. Intermediates, seniors. Intermediates did not go in the seniors' dressing. That's strictly off limits. But if we were getting a little bit low on the makeup, because we had proper grease paint, as good as they had in London, we had proper grease paint makeup. We used to get there early, go up the men's stairs, because they had everything, and pinch some of theirs. Never, ever admitted to it. But we, you know, for some reason, we never, ever went in the ladies' dressing room to pinch makeup. But we did the men. We used to try and sneak side stage because it was a full theatre stage. You've got to understand, it wasn't a little place, it was a huge place. And we'd try and sneak to see things. Because you must remember, we never, ever saw the show. We never, ever sat in front and saw the show. So we'd try and sneak side stage to see things. We'd get in trouble. We had the proper orchestra, you know, and it was conducted. And they had to turn up in black suit and dicky bow. You know, it wasn't, although it was only Buckley, a small town, the shows were massive, but there would be at least 15 to 20 coaches parked outside every night. My own cousin brought two coaches full from Doddleston to the pantomime. They came from everywhere. Even when we were running for 3 weeks, it's still came every night. And the day they opened for selling the tickets, there'd be a queue. My mum and mother used to go about 6:15 in the morning to get them, because we had no special treatment. Although we were, you know, members of the show, our parents had to queue for tickets like everyone else. The big flaps. I can remember we'd done a big scene of Queen Elizabeth and all these yeomen and all sorts. And there was an arch, but of course the big flies, the big pole at the bottom for weight. And Queen Elizabeth in this beautiful dress was Margaret Bell. And she stepped over it as the fly went up. Well, we nearly died. All sorts of funny things happened. You know, a spot wouldn't come on. And I'll tell you another one. We had halter neck costumes that just came up, and around our neck was a bell, and we all had a different toned bell, black and white with these skirts on and big. And we were crisscrossed at the back and we were dancing, and this girl was pulling in my hand to let go, and I thought, no, it's not ready to let it go yet. And when I looked, the front of her costume had dropped and this big bell was bouncing on a jet. Fortunately, we were only about 11.
So who was the driving force behind this?
Dennis Griffiths. Dennis Griffiths, definitely. And it had all started before the war. And I don't know exactly who the owners of the Tivoli were, but they were keen to have the Panto. And it gradually grew from 1 week, 2 weeks, to 3 week performances, but not on a Sunday. No performances on a Sunday. Every day, two on a Wednesday, two on a Saturday, but no shows on a Sunday, because Sunday was still very well observed then. Everyone rehearsed separately. The dancers rehearsed with Peggy Griffiths, and he told her what he wanted. The comedians rehearsed separately, and then there would be individual items like someone singing, or at one time a little skiffle group and things like that. But it was here, and he knew where it was all going. He knew where it was. He chose the music for the dances. He chose the music for the singers. He chose the comedy. But in his mind, and on his script, because he wrote the script, he knew exactly where everything slotted in. And he timed it. He came sort of very, very close to the pantomime. He timed how long every item took, so that you got the time factor down. And I don't ever remember them saying, oh, you'll have to cut that out, we haven't got time for it. And then on the Sunday night, which was the only Sunday that was ever used, we had the Tivoli for the dress rehearsal. And he wanted the dress rehearsal to be as good as the actual show. And it was. Everything just slotted into place. He worked hard, he wrote the scripts. Dennis Griffiths wrote all the scripts. He was a wonderful man, Dennis Griffiths. Did a lot of work for the youth, but we loved him. We absolutely loved him.